When I started gardening, grass meant something your parents hoped you never smoked, or it was something to mow on Saturdays. These days, native clumping grasses are finding spots in our gardens and landscapes for their majestic spring or fall plumes, year-round structure, and tolerance of our dramatic weather swings. Our friend and CTG host, John Hart Asher, senior environmental designer with Ecosystem Design Group, gets to the deep roots about why we want them in our gardens, what to pick, and how to plant. Hey, John Hart, it's great to see you, even though the tables have been turned a little bit with this webcam thing.
Yeah, that's all right. We'll make do.
So anyway, I know you're kind of a grassy sort of guy. What are clumping grasses, or we call them ornamental grasses?
Sure. Well, clumping grasses, the great thing about that name is that it's aptly describes what they do, right? So of the grasses, to make it so maybe an oversimplification, so all the plant nerds don't get on to me about this, but clumping grasses essentially kind of behave, right? They sort of stay where they are. And a lot of these clumping grasses tend to be some of the larger ornamental species that we really love to use in our garden. So clumping really just means, hey, you plant me here, I kind of stay.
We hear grass. What's the difference between that and turf grass, lawn grass? Aren't they all grasses?
Excellent question. Yes, they're all grasses. And we can talk a little bit more of that. But essentially, the grass species or varieties that we refer to when we're talking about turf grasses really are grasses that grow differently than the clumping variety. So most of our lawns have been designed so that they have really aggressive spreading characteristics. And if you want to get nerdy, that means that they're stoloniferous, so that they have above ground growth that the plant will put out and then touch the ground and then root and then keep on doing that. And then they also, some not only spread via their stolons, but they are rhizomatous, which means they also send material underneath the soil. And then that pops up. So you have a really aggressive a species of grass that just covers the ground really well. We're really talking about what their growth characteristics are.
And so then we often see sedges used mm-hmm. as ground covers to replace lawn. What is the difference between grasses and sedges?
Yes, well, we could really go down that rabbit hole, but again, to sort of simplify things, grasses and sedges are both graminoids, and they are both monocots, which mean they have a cotyledon. They flower in parts that are multiples of three. They have leaves with parallel veins, so on and so forth. We don't have to get so boring. But grasses are in the Poaceae family, whereas sedges are in the Cyperaceae. And so they're closely related, but they're a wee bit different. And grasses can be annuals or perennials, and you can have cool and warm season varieties. Sedges, they really tend to like shade. Sometimes they like a little bit more moisture. They could technically be called a cool season variety, but they tend to like the areas that might have a little bit more shade. And then if you look at the stems of the grasses, they tend to be hollow, and then they have these little nodes that come up in their leaf sheaths, whereas sedges, their stems tend to be solid, and they form a triangle. So there's a little thing that people use to help them memorize sedges versus grasses, which is sedges have edges.
So maybe we need to have a new t-shirt, John Hart. Sedges have edges.
Sedges have edges.
Well, then, so when it comes to the native clumping grasses, why do we want to plant them? What, aside from their beauty, what is their ecological role? How can they help us in our gardens?
Well, we will talk about the beauty really quickly. I mean, a lot of these larger specimens, and we'll go through a list of them here in a minute, but there's really large ones. There's medium-sized ones. There's small guys. So we've got the whole Goldilocks, the three bears going on with our grasses, right? And so some of those can serve as a really great visual specimen plant, right? They can give you a really nice covers or size or texture. They can also provide habitat. So grasses, the wonderful thing about this is that when you leave these grasses out in their dormancy, particularly in the winter, they provide a lot of habitat value. The stems on some of the larger grasses is where some of these insects bore in there and overwinter. Birds and other mammals use some of the grasses as nesting material. So they're really important to have that as a habitat value. Other part is water quality. Man, grasses are little micro water pumps, and they are really good at pulling out excess nutrients that might be spilling off of a lawn or something like that. So they can help us clean the water before that runs off of our property and goes into a drainage or something like that and then hits our rivers. Because if we have too many nutrients going to our rivers, we have algal blooms and really bad impacts to water quality that can cause fish kill, among other things. And then there's also erosion. Grasses have these huge, wonderful fibrous root systems that really anchor and hold down those grasses. So when we're doing riparian restoration, we want those sedges, we want those grasses, because if trees are the bones of a river, well, then the grasses and the sedges are the connective tissue. And together that forms this really resilient and robust structure that helps hold on to those grounds when we have those big high flood events. And then another thing with, you know, we all know about climate change. Well, grasses are wonderful at sequestering carbon. Prairies were a huge bank, so to speak, for our world's carbon before we plowed up a bunch of it. So these extensive root systems do a lot of work and really help us out as well as the environment.
The question a lot of people are going to ask, okay, so we got that. You sold us. We want them. We want them all. But if we're planting them in a normal yard, what do we do with them? Where can we put them? Can we walk on them? Is it just something we have to put to so that the soil doesn't erode or doesn't get muddy? But what if we have dogs, kids,
sure,
et cetera?
I've got all of those. And so I'm here to tell, to bear witness that you can have a very yes and approach, which we like to say. With your yard, you're going to have to determine, you know, really look at it from a point of, do you want something larger scale, which might be a pocket prairie, right? Do you want to use a majority of yard to cover up with grasses and all these forbs or wildflowers? Or do you want to do some plantings in some beds? Do you have more of a formal garden where you want to create some nodes and have some of this wonderful, specimen plantings that really allow some of that texture? You can also have rain gardens. Do you have an area where you have a lot of runoff? Okay, well, maybe you're going to create a depression and put some of these species, these what are called facultative species. That means they can take some inundation and then also take some dry. So we can put some of those species in there that'll help you retain water, keep that water on our land. We really want to try to do that as much as possible. We want to treat water as a resource, not as a waste product. But then we also can look at, do you want to create, you got kids, do you want to create a nature play area? Grass mazes are a wonderful component for kids to run through. They can get in there, they can see insects, they can have the tactile sense of feeling all those grasses. So there's a lot of ways. So you just got to think about what sort of strategy. Are you going more ornamental, more formal, or do you want it to be experiential? Or is it really something that's more about habitat value or some of those ecosystem services? Now, you know, talking about, can we walk on them? So this is tricky. We were just talking about the species of turf grass are designed to be pretty aggressive. So our grasses, they dealt with the buffalo, they dealt with the wildfires. They are really tough characters, all right? But they are not that aggressive spreading, especially the ornamental grasses. So they can take a licking, but repeated stuff, maybe not so much. But really, none of them are going to be as aggressive as, say, Bermuda grass or something that is just going to stay in there. And so that's a little bit of the trade-off that you've got to have is, you know, depending upon what you want to do, maybe sometimes you're just going to change it out every once in a while because you want high traffic. You want the kids, right? We do a playscape for kids. We don't want to create a garden of no. We want to create a garden of yes. So we're going to let them get in there and wrestle those things, and we're fine with that. If it's more of a formal garden, well, then, you know, or you're doing beds, well, then that's, you know, well, we don't walk there. So there's many ways how you can use to figure them out, but they're never going to be quite as aggressive as some of those more invasive turf species.
I know that we can plant them from seed. or mm-hmm. at least for some of them, we can buy transplants. Those are harder to find, but tell us, when and how do we plant?
The wonderful thing is it's spring and you can plant the grasses. This is the best time of year to plant, absolutely. So we're not going to go in, and I think we've talked on some past episodes about how you really want to prepare your land, but let's say you're ready to go. Well, seed is by far the most cheap way to get you a lot of diversity and to cover a lot of area. So if you're going to do a pocket prairie, that the grasses, this is your time from March into maybe May, depending upon what the weather does, you're good to go. If you're doing seed, you want to lightly loosen the soil. You don't want to deep till. Maybe add an inch or so of compost, spread your seed out by hand or something like that, and then you get a rake and lightly rake it in. You don't want to plant the seed too deeply. Anything deeper than twice the seed's width and diameter is too deep. And that's really technical, and you don't have to remember that. Just don't bury it too deep. And then what's really important is you want to recreate a really good wet year. So the first 10 days, you're going to water it and not let it dry out. The next 3 weeks, every other day, really good deep watering. And then the next 2 weeks, twice a week. So 10 days, solid wet. 3 weeks, every other day. 2 weeks, twice a week. And then you'll sit back and watch. You should be good to go. If you transplant, which I like to do with what we've called some of the later successional species, like little blue stem, big blue stem, some of these really need to have a good symbiotic relationship set up with the mycorrhizae in the soil, that your soil might not be there in urban land. So you can bring some of these in, and that helps you essentially inoculate your yard. It might not take the first few times. So just because you do it once and it doesn't work, you're not a failure. You might have to transplant a few times. And again, all of these are prairie species. So get in there, be rough, you're fine with that. But really, if you put those in, give those some water as well. You don't need to do a ton of fertilizing because you'll get a lot of weeds if you do a lot of fertilizing, but a little bit of organic fertilizer helps feed the microbes in the soil and helps feed the plants as well. And you can do that every couple of weeks in the spring.
So then when do we cut them back? Mm-hmm. And do you have some way to do it properly? I often see these kind of odd shapes. They're all cut back like this, like little balls. And then mm-hmm. little things come out like that, little stalks coming out.
Kind of like a little chia head thing.
That's it, exactly, yeah. Perfect. Chia grass. So,
chia grass.
Chia grass. Chia. So what do you recommend?
Well, removing that thatch is very important because nature would have given us our haircut every couple of years. So historically, again, in Texas, every 10 to 11 years, over 14 million acres would burn. So that would be our big barbershop appointment coming through and cleaning off that thatch. So it is good to remove that. You don't have to do it every single year. And maybe the first year or two, you can kind of leave it if you want.
Let's talk about some examples. A lot of us have shade and we're always looking for something for shade. So what do you recommend, and tell us if the ones that you like are annual or perennial, and mm-hmm. if they seed in the spring, or is it flower and seed in the spring or the fall?
A lot of the shade species tend to be cool seasons. And so I like to use, and to say this, I don't want people to expect the perfect turf. If you've got shade and you want a classic lawn, then you're really kind of pushed towards St. Augustine. It's, you know, water intensive and it is what it is. But if you really want a shady lawn, classic definition, that's kind of your limited somewhat. But if you're willing to open your horizons and not have that perfect mowed lawn, there's a lot of sedges and grasses that'll really do a lot for you. Some of those would be Texas bluegrass, Poa arachnifera. That's a great species. You really right now can only get it in live plantings. There's not a lot of seed available, but you can put that out there. That will flower. It's starting to flower right now in my pocket prairie. So you get that inflorescence, that seed head coming up now here in March or so. But the vegetation starts coming out well before that, really kind of the latter part of winter. Another one is Texas wintergrass. This is the one a lot of people call spear grass. They love to see. Again, this is one that you're going to have to get live plantings of because it's really hard to harvest this plant seed. You can get some, but it, when you do find it, tends to be a bit more expensive. But this is a great one. The ranchers don't love it. They call it an increaser because their cattle, it increases all over their ranch because the cattle don't really like it. But it's a wonderful, cool season. That really will hang around for most of the year. The Texas bluegrass will disappear, but that one really will be there, even though it's a cool season, for most of the year and will cover pretty well. Another one that's really good as well is inland sea oats. Now, this is a taller one that you might want to use on edges, and it can spread. But inland sea oats is one of our classic go-to shade species that really give you a lot of wonderful texture and color. And I just love this stuff. You might have to hack it back a little bit, but it is wonderful. However, the sedges really shine in some of these areas as well. So there's Texas sedge, Carex texensis, which is available vegetatively. And so you can put that out there and then feel free to mix some of the species. So if you want a really cohesive look, maybe pick a species. But if you want to mix some stuff up, that's fun too. So there's woodland sedge, Carex blanda. There's also meadow sedge, Carex perdentata. And there's also Carex leavenworthii, which is called lawn sedge. Now, the sedges don't really like a ton of traffic. So if you're going to have kids out there playing and whomping and whooping and the dogs are out there, you know, you might have to do a little bit of love and some replacement. And I've noticed in my areas where I had a lot of sedge, if I get more light than others, it can get a little cookie feeling at the end of summer. But for the most part, those are some really good options. So you're not limited. And by far, that's not an extensive list. But those are some go-to options that I like to use.
And then what about for sun?
Well, for sun, then you are in luck because we've got them all. So really some of these larger ones that we're talking about, ornamental grasses, big blue stem, little blue stem, Lindheimer muley, deer muley, seep muley, switchgrass, Gulf Coast muley, Eastern gamma grass, all these guys get pretty big. Switchgrass can get upwards to 8 feet tall. It's something that's really wonderful. And there's some great new varieties out there that give you some color. But all of those species, if you put those in for the most part, your problem is not if they're going to thrive, but it's just a little bit of the management because some of those are big. Lindheimer muley is a classic one. Great ornamental, great shape. You really don't have to do much. You can cut it back every couple of years. Not a big deal at all. You can leave that in there. Gulf Coast muley, some people like it, some people don't. I've used it and I found that where in my neck of the woods, my soils, it likes a lot more moisture than I really want to give some of my plants. So I haven't incorporated as much, but it is used beautifully in drifts with that nice purple color. That was always a big seller at the Wildflower Center plant sales when I was there. There's plenty of those big guys. And then there's mid-height prairie grasses like Sidoat scrumma, the state grass of Texas, blue grama, purple threon, Texas grama, vine mesquite, white tridens, Hall's panicum, green sprangletop, prairie wildrye, plains or southwestern bristlegrass. There's a whole heaping of them. And these guys maybe get to about a foot or two before they send up their fluorescence. So it's something that if you've got sun, you can use in a lawn area too. This middle mix really can be used quite well. And if you got a bunch of different species, they tend to be pretty resilient. And then we did create a habiturf at the center, which was a mix of buffalo grass, blue grama, and curly mesquite, which is a native lawn. And so Native American Seed sells some of this, a center turf. Douglas King Seed sells a habiturf. Either way, it's fine. But you put that out there, it needs at least 6 hours of sun. But this is really good, and it does put up with traffic pretty well. It's not going to be as performative as some of the invasive stuff, but it's going to do pretty well. And, you know, you can put a little bit of compost each year out there, maybe half inch, an inch, reseed a little bit, and you'll have a really thick loving lawn coming at you.
Well, I'm excited, whether it's sedges for edges or grasses for passes.
There you go.
Let's get planting. Well,
absolutely.
John Hart, thank you so much. It's really great to see you again. And so I'll seed you on the other side.
I'll seed you soon as well.